Absolutely.
So.
So I see Andrew on the line, but I would like to take Andrew after we take Cam, or Cam, I think.
Cam.
So Andrew, hold on. We're going to get to you. Cam in Wisconsin. You're talking to Eric.
Hello.
Hey.
Hello.
Okay, so the reason I called is I'm in a weird limbo between theism and atheism.
Okay.
Yep, been there.
Yep.
So, kind of a backstory. I was raised strictly Irish Catholic, and I don't know if you could argue the indoctrination just really took hold or something.
Sure.
But I know all the atheist points. I basically agree with all of them. All the theist arguments just don't hold water. Mm-hmm. But I've got this weird feeling in in my gut that, you know, just there's this part of me that just can't let go of belief. And I'm just kind of curious, as like a atheist, how do you let go of that?
Well, you give yourself time first. You're going to find, if you continue searching and you continue researching, bits and pieces fall away at a time. It's not a once and done kind of situation. It sounds like you're in the middle of this process, and no one's expecting you to drop everything and suddenly become somebody completely different. This is going to be a very long and intensive process. I am curious, though, what part of your belief are you clinging to, or do you find is hanging on more tightly than other pieces? Because maybe we can help with the individual piece that you're struggling with.
Well, it's kind of two things, really. One is simply summed up with basically like a hyper version of Pascal's wager.
Okay.
Where my brain overanalyzes things. Sure. And so the basic premise of Pascal's wager, if it were a true dichotomy, would make an extremely good point. But it's not a true dichotomy because there's multitudes of different religions with multitudes of different punishments for not believing, et cetera, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, but then my brain has this gut fear reaction of, okay, one of those could be correct. And then what's going to go on? You know what I mean?
Yeah. It sounds like you've already got the answer, dude. It sounds like you're there.
But the fear still exists.
Yeah.
It's kind of my point there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are still things that from being raised Christian that impact me.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm 43 years old, right? And I kind of, through grade school, CCD, CYO, I did take a look at the Bible and say, okay, what I'm learning from science is not jiving with this. Science seems to have really good evidence, so let's just ignore that junk, right? And so I looked at Buddhism. Mm-hmm. And then I spent probably 15 years of my life as a Wiccan.
Okay.
And it's just been about a year ago that I came across your show, The Atheist Experience.
Nice.
A lot of other YouTube videos, did research into like Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens' writings. And it mm-hmm. all makes a lot of sense, but I just can't let go of that gut feeling. You know,
that's very interesting to me for a couple of reasons. The first is that was almost exactly my path out of religion as well. Was Christian, wait, maybe Buddhism, wait, maybe Wicca, wait, maybe I'm just an atheist. So like that path is one that I'm well familiar with, and I know many people do experience on that in that exact order. So you're not alone there. I'm also curious because did you have these fears while you were practicing Wicca for 15 years? Because that's not necessarily a compatible belief system to the kind of fears that you're talking about now. So I'm curious, did they come back after you started thinking about atheism a bit more, or how does that work?
Wow, that actually gets really deep into kind of my whole philosophy of everything, which if I can try to drill it really, really briefly, it's that the idea of a God, by definition, cannot be understood by humans. If it could be understood, it couldn't have all the omnis. Therefore, any one individual religion cannot possibly have a cornerstone on the truth. They all have a version of the truth. Kind of like if you drew kind of a rough S on the ground, but then you looked in the mirror, it could be a two. Mm-hmm. Both of them, in from a certain point of view, are the truth.
So
kind of like Obi-Wan and everything.
Yeah, this kind of path is going to take you to, what is it? Baha'i, Baha'u'llah. Don't do it, man. Don't do it. Assuming that they all have some part of the truth is giving them something that they don't deserve. They haven't gotten to the point where it's reasonable to assume that. When you look at the claims, if you're stacking your beliefs and what you understand about the world on a house of cards, that's bad. And you already know that. The fact that there are lots of houses of cards doesn't make it better. It's just a whole lot of crap.
I'm completely agreeing with you on that.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
And that's where mentally I could consider myself an atheist.
Rock on.
Okay.
But there's that emotional gut feeling.
And
that no matter how much I think about it, mm-hmm. it just in my heart of hearts, I cannot truly, honestly say to myself, I don't actually believe in a God. If you ask me why I believe, I have no clue. I have no reason. I have no rationality.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It's just that there's that gut feeling.
That's the indoctrination talking right there.
Yeah.
It's living in a society where the majority of people believe in a God. Of course that's going to rub off on you. Of course you're going to have trouble getting over that concept because every religion, almost every religion, not all, have that concept of a God, and it's baked into our society. It's baked into the way we say things and the words we use and the cultures and the rituals that we perform on the day-to-day. So, yeah, emotionally, it is going to take you time to get to the same place that you are mentally. You're not in the wrong place right now. You're not behind.
It's not bad. In fact, it's the most common.
Yeah.
You're not alone.
And it's going to take time. But you're there mentally, and that's what's important.
Because you wouldn't buy a house because you had a good gut feeling. You wouldn't invest your money. You wouldn't give your money over to somebody who said, oh, no, totally. I'm totes my goats going to invest this for you and everything's going to work out fine. If all you have is a gut feeling, you're not going to do it.
But if I may give kind of an analogy, it's not going to be perfect, but an analogy nonetheless, okay? Years ago, I had a girlfriend. I had a gut feeling she was cheating on me. I had no evidence. I had no reason to believe this. She was doing whatever while I was at work. Everything was cleaned up when I got home. There was absolutely no logical indication that I should believe this. But it was still the truth, as it turns out, she admitted later.
Can something coincidentally be true?
Oh, absolutely. I get that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's the same question we ask theists. Is faith a reliable path to truth? Can you have faith in something that is true? Yes. But is faith a thing that makes it true? Can you prove it because of faith? No. The same with gut feeling. You can have a gut feeling about something and that thing is true, but you're not using the gut feeling to determine whether or not that thing is true because it can just as likely be untrue.
If you need examples for that, check out Fyre Festival.
Fyre Festival. I've not heard of this.
Oh, my goodness. You need to look it up. There are multiple documentaries. It was bad. It was real bad. Anyway, we're going to get on to the next caller, but hopefully that helps.
All right. Actually, it has been very helpful. Thank you.
That's sweet. Awesome. Call back.
Definitely.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Fire Festival. Yep. Okay.